Sound speeds, and welcome to part three of Can You EQ a Bad Mic to Sound Good? Now, part three is going to live just about entirely on the screen of my computer. Now, if you watched the previous videos, and if you haven't, I strongly recommend you catching up first. I talked about the equalization of the microphones being done in Audacity, and the reason why is because the idea is that if you have a cheap $17 microphone like this Neewer NW-700, then you probably don't have much of a budget if you're going to try to make this work for you. So knowing that, a free program like Audacity should be what we try to use to pull one over on people and see if we can actually make it sound like a higher quality microphone than it really is. So let's jump over to the computer and see what exactly I did.
Okay, before we really get going here, I wanted to show you that I did two voiceover passes with this Neewer microphone. As you're currently listening to it right now, you're seeing that it matches the video, and therefore you can tell that this is actually the audio that we're using. We're going to pick one of these in a second, and we're going to modify it. Now, also by default, Audacity loads up into this weird linear mode, which is as you can look at the screen, you can see where it goes from 0.0 to 1.0 and negative 1.0. This doesn't really do us a whole lot of good. We would rather drop down the list and go to decibels. The difference basically is this is linear, this is logarithmic. And basically, logarithmic is what you'd rather use because decibels are logarithmic. In a nutshell, what that basically means is that you're going to see that the audio levels totally change, and that's because the difference between negative 60 and negative 50 decibels is totally different in reality than negative 10 to 0 decibels. So if you notice now, I'm actually widening out the waveform. That way, when I turn it into spectrogram mode, you can see a greater detail of the graphic representation of the sound. Now, if you look here, it starts at 0K hertz, goes up to 24K hertz. Now, most vocal frequencies are going to be around here up through this whole area. So this is where my voice basically comes into play. Anything that's above that is basically, you know, still my voice, but that's probably overtones and undertones or what all these would be. And if you're not familiar with what those are, link down in the description. Okay, so let's look at this gap between the two voiceovers I'm doing. Vice. Okay, so this is where the voiceover finishes, and these little sounds right there are maybe me breathing, maybe a little background noise or something like that. But right there, where that blue is peaking up from right here to right there, in between that is about the quietest it's going to get. That's the noise floor. The noise floor, if you're not familiar, watch this video up here. And I'll go ahead and give you a tidbit of knowledge on it. Basically, a noise floor is the lowest volume the room environment that you're shooting in can possibly be. Anything lower is obviously not going to be possible because this is your noise floor. That is the very bottom level your sound could ever be. No quieter. Now, if you notice, my noise floor is actually incredibly quiet, and you can't even hear the background noise in this room underneath the voiceover. The entire voiceover covers it up completely. You'll never hear those frequencies. To remove your background noise altogether in Audacity, it's extremely easy to do. You simply highlight your noise floor, go up to Effect, and then Noise Reduction. Step one. Get noise profile. Click that button. From there, you want to highlight your entire document with a double click, hit effect, go to noise reduction again, and then under step two, these are your settings, double check that it says reduce, and then hit OK. From there, watch this background noise completely go away. Now, if you look at both sides of my voiceover here, you'll notice that there is no noise in the background. The noise floor has completely been removed, but I didn't do that in the voiceover processing I did, so I'm going to undo that noise reduction. What I did do, though, is I zoomed in, and I highlighted from the very start of the edge of that voiceover, and I removed everything from there. I went to Effect. I went down to, where is it? Generate Silence. That was it. And then I hit OK, and that basically blocks the whole thing out. That is completely dead quiet now, and then I'll do the same thing at the end. So by now, we've already started to process our first voiceover, so we're going to go ahead and hit delete on that highlighted second voiceover, and we're going to get rid of it. Now, if I want to come over here and basically silence this, I'm going to generate silence, hit play, and okay. Let's listen to that. Nice. Oh, I heard a pop right there. I'm not happy with that. I'm going to hit undo that silence right there. Let's zoom in a little bit more. And I'm going to highlight up to, let's see if I take that little bit out there. Is that the pop we heard before? Generate silence and, okay, let's back up this thing just a little bit and listen to it. Sound advice. I did not hear a pop, and it sounds dead quiet after that. This waveform drops down, and instantly that's where the noise floor would normally pick back up, but it's not there. So we don't need to worry about this anymore, and that would be one of the reasons why Mike Delgadio said he did not hear that gate opening or closing. It's because there wasn't one. It's simply dead silence at the beginning and end of the voiceover. Uh-oh, look at that. I didn't even do the beginning of this. I'm going to do this again in the waveform mode, and you're going to see generate silence is going to completely quiet this entire thing. I didn't even go all the way up to the end there. We'll do it one more time to completely quiet this thing out. And now, have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure to write it in the comment section down below. Okay, now we're ready to take this to the next step, equalization. Because I'm sure inquiring minds are going to want to know, these are the frequency response patterns for each of the microphones we tested and did a voiceover for. Every single one of these was taken from the documentation that I could find online. Well, except the Neewer NW-700. For this, I actually had to take a picture of the pamphlet that came with the microphone and photoshopped it so it looked like it would belong with the rest of them. Now, I do want to point out that the Shure SM7B I ran in completely flat mode, which is just this black line right there. I did not use the roll-off. I did not use the high shelf. On the C4000B, I ran it in cardioid mode, which is why that's there. And of course, the CAD Equitek E100, I did not use the roll-off on that. As a matter of fact, I did no roll-offs on any of these microphones. Okay, before we do anything, let's actually listen to what we're dealing with here. Have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure to write it in the comment section down below. Or if you'd like to make a suggestion for a future topic of discussion, again, comment section down below, or you can send me an email at soundspeeds@yahoo.com. Be sure to subscribe and turn on notifications so you don't miss out on future sound advice. Okay, so that's what we're dealing with here. Now let's go up to Effect, Equalization, and start playing. By default, it's set to Flatten. Now, if I were to guess, I would say this thing is probably in major need of some low end. However, what I'm going to do first before I do anything else is I'm going to create a roll-off, and that's basically going to be from about right here at 80 decibels. I'm sorry, it's going to be right here from about 80 hertz down to 20 hertz. And anything from there is going to basically be rolled off. You see my little green curve right there is basically from where I'm kind of grabbing and pulling from. So what I'm going to do initially here is I'm going to create some false low end by going up a little bit higher. I'm going to give it about 6 dB. So around 80 hertz is going to be about there. And then I'm going to slowly start ramping it off around 100. And we'll see if going down to maybe flat around 200 hertz, if that gives me anything. Let's listen. Have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure to write it in the comment section down below. Okay, so it sounds like we're starting to get a little someplace. Let's go ahead and do this and see what happens there. Have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure. Okay, it's slowly starting to get there. I'm not exactly happy with the way it's starting to sound, but I'm going to play with it a little bit more and see what we can come up with. Have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure to write it in the comment section down below. Okay, so it's starting to kind of shape itself out a little bit. We're going to play a little bit more. Have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure to write it in the comment section down below. And then I just kept working my way on up the frequencies until I came up with this right here. This is the actual equalization processing that I applied to the NW-700 to try to pull one over on you and Mike Delgadio. Notice I actually added a little bit of low end there, and then it kind of went flat for a bit. And then around the 2K mark, I started to go up a little bit for a high shelf. And that's because I wanted to kind of create a little bit of a crispness boost right up in there. I guess you could almost say it was a presence boost when it hit about this point. But for the low end, most of the cheaper microphones do not represent the low end very well, even though it says it's acoustically flat on the frequency response chart. And so I wanted to actually add some to try to fatten it up a little bit. As a matter of fact, this is the actual processing I did to each of the microphones you heard. This is the Shure SM7B. You notice it's relatively flat, but I did end up going up and down just a little bit, only a decibel or two in a couple of the frequency ranges just to try to even it out a little bit. And then, of course, I added a lot of brightness at the end. Now, the Neewer NW-700, we've already seen. The CAD Equitek E100 was basically flat for the most part. I did add some low end, and of course, I added some high end there for presence boost. As for the AKG C4000B, you saw even on Mike Delgadio's face, the low end on that microphone when I got all the way up on it, the proximity effect kind of wiped it out. So I actually had to remove quite a bit of the low end, but then it started to suffer a little bit because of that low end around the mids and highs, so I ended up adding quite a bit of that back in. So for our demonstration here, I basically recreated the equalization curve that I applied to my voiceover before. Now let's hit preview and see how well I did duplicating it. Have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure to write it in the comment section down below. Sounds about like it did before to me, so I'm going to hit OK. Now get this. That's all the processing I did before, so let's listen to it in its completion. Have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure to write it in the comment section down below, or if you'd like to make a suggestion for a future topic of discussion, again, comment section down below, or you can send me an email at soundspeeds@yahoo.com. Be sure to subscribe and turn on notifications so you don't miss out on future sound advice. No, I did not equalize it any further. Believe it or not, I did not normalize it, nor did I use a compressor on this file. All I did was those two steps. I quieted the beginning and end, and then I simply EQ'd it. That's it.
So there you have it. I kept it very simple. Because I was talking so close to the microphone, I just had to mute the beginning and end of the audio track, and then you wouldn't hear any background noise. And then I simply equalized it until you no longer heard any of the defining characteristics of each microphone, and they all sounded more or less the same. From there, I normalized it up to 0 dB and saved the audio clips. I typically limit the audio processing that I do in my videos here on SoundSpeeds to 5 different components. Number 1 is I remove all the background noise. Number 2 is I add a gate just in case something sneaks through. Number 3 is I equalize the low end of my voice just a little bit because, as we know, I don't have much low end. Number 4 is I compress it. Number 5 is I normalize it. From there, I put it into my video editing program and run wild. Thank you for staying with us for all 3 parts of this video where we EQ'd a bad mic to sound more presentable. Notice I didn't say to sound like a good mic because it's simply that, more presentable. So in the future...
Wait a second, stop right there. Let's actually go back over to the computer for a second. That's right, I'm not quite done with you yet, because if you notice in front of me is this Neewer NW-700 microphone. That's right, the cheap $17 microphone is the microphone I've been using for the voiceovers I've done this entire video. Did I fool you? Because this time I did the exact same processing I just walked you through, except I changed up the equalization just a little bit because I'm not trying to trick you anymore. I did a best effort equalization to see if I could pull one over on you. Did it work? Tell me in the comment section down below if I fooled you. Now, we can resume the closing of this video.
If you have any questions or comments, be sure to write them in the comment section down below. I will look at them. Regardless, thanks for tuning into this episode of SoundSpeeds, and be sure to tune into the future where we're going to have more fun and sound advice.
Have a question you'd like answered or want to add something? Be sure to write it in the comment section down below. You can also make a suggestion for future topics of discussion. Again, comment section down below, or you can email me at soundspeeds@yahoo.com. Be sure to subscribe and turn on notifications so you won't miss out on future sound advice.